agreement on the most significant part of President Obama's health care law. That is the requirement that everyone must have health insurance.
The justices began considering that controversial law on Monday. Chief legal correspondent Jan Crawford is at the Supreme Court this morning. Jan, good morning.
Well, good morning, Erica. This is the big day that could well decide the future of this law. Protesters already are out here on the front of the Supreme Court as the justices get ready to decide these enormous constitutional issues about the government's power to tell people what to do. Can Congress go out and order you to get health insurance? That's an issue the court has never before considered, because Congress has never ordered people to go out and buy anything, not even during war or the Depression. But first, there is another issue. Yesterday, the justices heard arguments on whether or not they could even decide this case right now. Outside the court, people for and against President Obama's health care law made their voices heard. But inside, the debate was technical and cerebral as the justices delved into challenges over the 2,700-page law. The case raises fundamental questions of federal power over American lives. But on day one, they dealt with a basic legal question. Is it too soon for the court to hear the case? At issue is whether the penalty people will pay for refusing to buy insurance amounts to a tax. If it does, the argument goes, the court can't hear the case until someone actually pays the tax, which won't happen until 2015, after that part of the law goes into effect. Some of the justices were skeptical.
They called it a penalty and not a tax for a reason. They wanted it to fall outside that. It's in a different chapter, etc.
But today's arguments will go to the heart of the most controversial part of the law, the individual mandate. The court will hear from opponents, including 26 states, who say Congress has no power under the Constitution to tell anyone to buy anything. Under the Constitution's Commerce Clause, Congress has power to regulate commerce. Opponents say that's true, but they can't create it. The Obama administration is countering, saying health insurance is unique because, unlike all other products, everyone will need health care. Now, many people think that this case will divide the justices just as it's divided America. That's pretty hard to predict. We'll have a much better idea of that after we hear their questions during this historic two-hour argument. Charlie and Erica.
Jan, thanks very much. Republican Senator Tom Coburn of Oklahoma has been a fierce critic of the president's health care law. Senator, good morning.
Good morning, Charlie. How are you?
I'm good. Senator, I think I know how you stand on health care, but with respect to the issues before the Supreme Court, do you hope the court says to the United States, this entire health care law is unconstitutional?
I certainly do. I praise the Obama administration for wanting to address the issue. There's no question we have problems. Health care costs too much. But every claim about this bill is going to be disproven, both in terms of its savings, its delivery of care, and its affordability. It's highly unaffordable. We're now at $2.6 trillion over the first 10 years of what it's actually going to cost in increased taxes and spending by the federal government. So my hope would be, and for another reason, Charlie, is the Commerce Clause. And the expansion of it is the reason we're running trillion-dollar deficits. You and I have had this conversation before. We're in such a big financial hole. And if you go back to look at why we are, is because the federal government has gotten outside the bounds of what we were ever intended to do. And one of the ways we did that was by expanding the Commerce Clause to have us involved in things that are really not our purview under the Constitution.
Well, David Brooks in today's New York Times, who's a Hamiltonian and someone who I suspect in many cases you share views with, says, in my own view, the individual mandate is perfectly acceptable policy. We effectively have a national health care system. We all indirectly pay for ill, uninsured people who show up at an emergency room. If all Americans are in the same interconnected health care system, I think it's reasonable for government to insist that all Americans participate in the insurance network, that is the payment method for that system.
Well, we just don't have the authority to tell people to do that. That's fine for some columnists to write that. David Brooks, he's right. He's a Hamiltonian. I'm not. I'm a Madisonian. And that says as government grows, freedom diminishes. And what we've seen is our freedom diminish. Plus, it's not working. How well is Medicare working right now, Charlie? How well is Medicaid working? None of them are working well. They're totally bankrupt programs. We can't afford them. The care is declining. Even though you say you can have access, you don't really get access. 40% of the people who are now coming into Medicare are having trouble finding a physician that will take Medicare. It's not working. And the reason it doesn't work is we're not using market forces to allocate a resource and creating a true safety net to help those people who need help.
My understanding,
so
then,
we're outside of our role as a federal government.
So therefore, you do not support the requirement for pre-existing condition, nor the fact that children up until the age of 26 will come under the parents' plan.
Charlie, that's not it. The point is I support a true market where you can actually go in and buy something. The point being is we're going to make everybody buy something, or we're going to say if we don't do that, then some consequences of market failure we can't tolerate, so therefore we'll no longer trust markets, and we'll have a system where the government sets the rules on everything. There is a choice in between there. And the choice says, and I don't have any problem with what you do on terms of insurance, but where is it the role for the federal government to set that? What's wrong with the state set? What's wrong with us allowing insurance to be bought and sold across state line? One of the reasons, we don't have a real market in insurance. That's the reason everybody wants to try to fix it. Before we criticize the market base, we ought to go back and say, could we have a real market? And we've not done that.
To be continued, Senator Coburn. Thank you so much.
All right, Charlie.
This morning, the president is on his way home from a summit in South Korea where he shrugged off some criticism for asking Russia's president to put off some key issues for political reasons.